Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. This video is a sort of a response to an issue that I discovered in one of my earlier videos. In fact, if you go right now to the channel, to the playlist of this course, the electronics and microprocessors list, and you go to video number 6, Introduction to Python, specifically around this time, you know, 2 hours and 12 minutes, you will see that I have done this part of the code. And basically the print statement, please input as integer, x equal to input. And I said that at the time that will it be captured as an integer, then print, if you try to print it, it won't work. You'll have to cast it as a string. And then we agreed that the casting is just temporary, just for this line, and then when you try to do the operation to continue as an integer. And then, in fact, if you have done this and you watch the video and you see me doing it and then running my code, then it will work just fine. I'm gonna, in fact, run the video. And then in the video, actually, I play and I run this code and it shows that it's actually working. But if you try to do it yourself, it won't work. And actually, I'm gonna show you now the same code. I recreated the same code in my Genie, and here's essentially the program itself. So here we are. We have input, and please input integer, input, and then capture. Exactly, I recreated the whole thing, and then basically captured as integer, and then if we actually run this right now. If you run this version of the program, it will also run just fine. The problem is not exactly here. The problem will come later, as you already know by now. So compile. But I want to show you the situation now and then explain to you what the cause of the problem. So run as integer 5, 5, or 4, it works. So when does the problem begin then? Well, the problem begins if, let's say, I come later and try to do the if statement. So if I say, if we uncomment this group of this block of code, let's say if x is less than 5, print this statement that says that the number is bigger than or equal to 5. There, bigger than or equal to 5. So if x is greater than or equal to 5, then if that's true, then print this statement. If otherwise, print this statement. And you already know what's going to happen, but I'm going to do it anyway. So compile, build, execute, and put 5 or 4. We get this lovely error. And this is the error that some of my students already reported to me and saying that, sir, when you run the program in the video, it runs just fine. And when I copy exactly the same step like you do, it doesn't work. What's going on here? Well, what's going on here is that when I created the video, In the earlier video was actually in last year, 2020, or maybe even earlier than that. I think it was the video itself was created, last year. But then at the time when I was recording the video, I was using Python 2.7, and which is the older Python. At the time, Python is changing, and the new Python or Python 3 was introduced in 2018. See, the introduction to Python 3 and Python 2, the introduction to from one Python to another doesn't happen in a day. It happens over a period of time. And basically, at the time, the code that I was working on was fine according to the rules from Python 2.7 or 2.x. Any 2. Something would work on this code. But then when you run it on Python 3, then you're going to run into a problem. So first of all, before we get into the problem itself, we need to talk about the fact that Python is changing, and it's not the only problem that you're going to see going from 2 to 3. So first of all, let's talk about that for a minute. Now, Python 3 was introduced in 2018, as I just said, and there's a lot of changes. And see, people are still talking about it even in 2020. You know what I mean? Now, even in 2020 or even in 2021, you still may have to learn Python 2. And there is a fundamental reason for that. And this article, I'm going to share the links to it in the description in this video to it. Now, why? What are the reasons why Python 2 would be important or still important to learn? Now, Python 2 has been around for 20 years. And therefore, a lot of libraries, a lot of programs, and a lot of training materials and tutorials and videos like the very one you're watching now are based on Python 2. So when you're learning for the first time and you're watching YouTube videos or tutorials online, you might be watching YouTube, you might be watching videos on Python 2. So you might be seeing code and stuff like that, and that actually was valid in Python 2, but then it's no longer valid in Python 3. It's exactly what's going on in our example. What you saw in my video was code that is valid in Python 2, and then it's not valid in Python 3. Now you might be thinking, sir, can I just run it on Python 2 myself and be over with it? Can, but then why would you? The future is Python 3, and I'm no longer, actually I completely switched to Python 3 recently, but my videos are still Python 2, but I'm also in the thinking about going back and changing all the videos. It's a time-consuming effort, but then again, if I do that and I erase all my previous videos and I do new videos on Python 3, you will miss the opportunity to learn the difference between the two Pythons. It's very important that, okay, maybe my videos were updated, but what about other people's videos, other tutorials? And more importantly, code online, libraries, solutions, and stuff like that. When you look it up online, again, it will be or could be Python 2. So you need to be, in my opinion, it's better than you, for you as a beginner, right, is to understand the differences between them. And then, of course, moving forward, go to Python or focus on Python 3. So apart from this difference, which is the, actually, this article is nice. The first article is nice as to explain to you the history, why the change, and what are the benefits of Python 3. But it does not, this article, it does not list every change. The second article I'm going to also provide you the link with is actually coming from W3 Source, which is the same or related to W3 Schools, the one we use to learn the program itself. So this list is very distinct, very detailed, showing you exactly all the differences between Python 3 and Python 2. And it shows you in a very nice and perfect way, putting you the code side by side between Python 3 and Python 2 to the same feature. So you will see, by the way, when you go through the differences, that you'll notice that there is a number of fundamental differences between Python 2 and Python 3. Basically, one famous change is how the print statement works. You would notice that now that we have brackets in print statement, but in the past we didn't have to. So some of my earlier tutorials, maybe the beginning ones, or maybe not this course, maybe the earlier one before that, I used to use this print statement, and then this is no longer valid anymore. If you try this now, it will give you an error, because Python 3 does not recognize it. You have to use the bracket. And also another issue was the division by an integer. Believe it or not, in Python 2 in the past, if you take 5 divided by 2, you're going to get 2, not 2.5. That's because you have an integer divided by integer, the result must be an integer. That's the logic in the past, which was, of course, incorrect mathematically. So that's why this now has been fixed in Python 3. So that's one other issue. Another example or another difference is Unicode, which is a way that characters are defined in programming. You see, when you write a letter, S, T, H, whatever character you write, it's translated into zeros and ones. How does that translation happen? We have to follow some sort of a standard. In the past, the standard used was ASCII, which is ASCII. And then essentially that was the code used in Python 2. But then nowadays we use the more, much more improved, a much bigger definition or standard, which is the Unicode. With Unicode, you can actually code or program symbols. Like you can, for example, you can write the code for the simple pi or the simple alias or theta or something like that. So all of these symbols, you can actually include them, and they can be displayed as an output or you can as a value in your program. In the past, in Python 2, none of that was possible. One other difference, of course, that you already have seen it, which is essentially the input, which is shown right here in the very end of it. And that brings us back to our problem. And you know what? Let's go to W3 Schools as well. I want to show you the same situation in the same page. W3 Schools, Python, input. And yeah, so if you go there to this page and you see now that now this is now the two cases. Now let me show you one more time what's going on here. In Python 2, there used to be two types of input function. Apart from input, there used to be also raw input. So you know what, let me not touch this code. I want to keep it here for a minute. Yeah, let me put this aside. Just copy this guy. And put down a little bit here, away from the others. I'll put it here. So this is actually one way of capturing user input. You know what, just bring me this. Okay. Now, there is another input, and it's not captured as an integer. By the way, I want to explain one other thing. When I say that captured as an integer, or in the video on my YouTube channel, when it says captured as an integer, I did not mean that it captures by an integer all the time. I was talking about this particular instance in our program, or in this particular context. That brings me now to this program right here. So right here, this is input. Okay, what about the other one? The other one essentially is raw input. Raw input. So what is the difference between these two? So in Python 2, I'm just gonna actually put it here. So Python, what is that thing? Yeah, okay. Python 2, or yeah, Python 2.x. In Python 2.x, we have two ways of capturing user input. And the first one is input, as you can see it here. But then it does not capture as an integer. It simply captures based on the context. What does that mean? Based on the context. What does that mean, context? It's basically based on the value itself. So if you typed, let's say, let's just say it right here. If user typed 7, right? Let's just say the user inputted 7, right? So because this is an integer, or looks like an integer, so input will actually consider it, or define it, or you know, will define its type as integer. How? Because it's based on the context. What does that mean? That because it looks like an integer, so it will make it as an integer. Now, if the user typed say 7.45, then input will actually define it as a float. You get what I mean? Let's go one more time. So if the user typed something like a string, so let's say, you know, whatever you want here, right? Then this looks like a string or a bunch of characters, so therefore this will be a string. So this is what I mean by context. What does that mean? I mean, basically, it depends on the situation, really. It depends on what the user actually inputs. And therefore, input essentially will look at what the user inputted, and it tries to make the best guess into the type and then assign it. Now, remember, this was in 2.x only, or in old Python, okay? Now, there was another way in Python 2.x. It's called raw input. And the raw input always captured always as a string. No matter what you type, it will always be captured as a string. So if I take all of these right here, okay, just copy paste all of that and put it here. So, and also put raw input, okay? Copy and then put it here. And this one as well here. So now what will happen? Define this type as a string. And this one is a string also. So basically, what will that mean? A string basically will mean like this. It will be this string right here. And this one will also be a string, but the string will be 7.5. Okay, although it's a number, but essentially it will be considered as a string, as a character really. And this one is obviously, it will be a string as well. So SDFAS. Yeah, so that's basically, all of them will be considered as a string. So that was how Python 2.x worked. You have two ways of working with an input. One of them was basically like a magical wand, really. It basically thinks by itself, and it tries its best way to determine the input based on whatever the user inputs. So What about Python 3? What happened? Well, in Python 3 now, I'm going to copy all of this and paste it here. So now in Python 3x or in the next generation or the Python 3 in general, right? Well, basically what happened was is that all what they did was simply all of this now goes away. And you know what? Yeah, let me just take all of this. Well, I'm going to do it, and you're going to see now what happens is that the new situation now. So this will be here, and this will be also here, and also here, and essentially, and that is a goodbye. So now this is the situation in Python 3. In Python 3, there is no longer raw input. Raw input has been deprecated. Deprecated simply means no longer in use. Deprecated. And ignore this part. Deprecated, the word here, deprecated, simply means it's no longer in use. But they cannot simply say it's no longer in use because it's still used in earlier libraries. So deprecated means it's no longer in use in future libraries. Meaning, what deprecate really means that we basically, what they're trying to tell you is that we would like to inform you, like we want, we, okay, or please be informed that this is no longer used, no longer used, but it might still be used in older libraries, in legacy libraries. Legacy is a nice way of saying older libraries, okay? So what does that mean? So whenever you see the word deprecated, it simply means the following, that this is no longer used. Do not use it in future libraries or future function. And just so you know that it might still appear in older libraries. So raw input is now deprecated. Raw input. That is why, by the way, I did not use it in my older tutorials, in my older videos themselves. I did not use it. I used input itself. Now, you must be thinking, okay, sir, when you made the video, you made it last year, and last year you also used 2.7. Why not? It did not work today? Well, basically, during the transition from 2.7 to 3.x, there is a transition period. During this transition period, the two systems, 2.7 and 3.x, they will be allowed to exist side by side, is now deprecated, okay? So basically allowed to exist side by side. So even if you run code in 2.x, it might for a while be all right or whatever, but then you should basically now allowed or should basically move forward from it. So although last year I was able to get away with it with my video or my code last year, this year is no longer valid. So what is the implication to this? What is the implication for this change on my previous video? See, let me open that page again. So let me just jump. So you see, in the video, what happened was is that in the video, I used input and from the 2.x version of Python. So it was context based. So that is why when you type a number, let's say 7, it will capture it as an integer. That's what I meant here. And that's why when you try to do this line of code, which is print, you enter this and that, it won't work using the... Actually, it will still work with str because it's already a string. Cast it with a string, it will work. But then later on when you want to do the math, it won't work. Or in other words, here, what happened here is essentially, in the past, this worked because it was context-based. But now this is no longer work. So what I'm going to do right now, you know what? Let's bring this back here. Okay, so I'm going to, this F statement, I'm going to bring it down here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take the whole thing, and I'm going to tell you, show you what you need to change to, in order to make the work work, I mean, in order to make the code work for Python 3. Actually, you know what, there is one thing else I wanted to do. Let's just come here. Before this, I want to add print type X. That's it. And what is this function is going to do is going to print the variable type of X. And I'm going to do it again here. So basically, this code, this line of code right here, what it does essentially, it prints out the type of variable X. And I'm going to do it immediately here, right after I actually used input. So last time we said that if you use a Python 2, this will be an integer. So by right, we should see integer here. So let's take a look. Run again. So 4. I did not hide the rest of the code. So let me comment out this part for a minute so that the error doesn't happen here. So run this again. So 5 or, 4. See, this is a string. So this is basically the output of this line right here is the output of is the output of this line right here, which is input type input right here. So when you print type input, this is going to be class str. So it's telling you that the output is a string. So even though I typed 4, and in the old way or in the old video, this was supposed to be an integer. Unfortunately, now it's basically a string. And the reason for that is that because Python 3 no longer works with no longer applies this style anymore. Now it's simply input does not have context. Does not have any more context. Input now simply works as a string, all the time as a string. So no matter what you type, it's going to be a string. So that means what? That means I didn't really have to do this line right here. So basically now, since this is already a string, if you cast a string to a string, doesn't hurt, but then redundant really, but actually this would still work now. Because now this is now essentially already a string. So now, go back. Yeah, so I wanna, this is the code as it was in my old video, essentially, right here, right? And this was the code. So what I wanna do right now is I'm gonna copy paste the whole thing and put it back here, but this time I'm gonna apply the Python 3 changes. Okay, so first of all, I just want to add a note here, context, in that context. I just want to clarify that integer doesn't mean that it's always an integer. It simply means in that context, in that earlier video, in that context, it will be an integer. But now, this will always be as a string. So if it's already a string, there is no need to cast it as a string anymore because it's already a string. And if you do that, nothing is going to happen, but it's redundant. And therefore, there's no need for this line at all. And of course, it's not an integer. It's still a string. Okay, so right now, if you come here now, and you try and do this F statement. So basically, this is now the changes so far. But by the way, this does not solve our problem. Let's just put this 2.7 code aside. And then now we see the Python 3 code. So now you use the input, and the user have inputted an integer, or let's just call it a between two parentheses an integer. Let's just put an example 4. Okay? So now you're trying to run this F statement. The problem with this is now this right here, this 5 here, is an integer. But then you are comparing not an integer, but a string. If you want, this is how it's going to look like. This is actually how what you're trying to do. Try to compare a string versus an integer. That won't work. Python 3 no longer have a magical wand that is given to input. Input will always be a string. So if you want this F statement to work, then you have to assign this. You have to make sure that this 4 right here is actually an integer. So how you do that is you can simply do this right here. You can simply say integer, and that would work. That basically will consider the value, will basically cast the value as an integer. And then this time, this guy will no longer be it will be converted from this into essentially into this. Into this. So now become a real integer and the F statement will work and you're not going to get the error. So far, so good. However, this actually, although we solve this particular problem, but then this will create other problems when we go to ahead in our video, particularly speaking, when we go to the next video. You see, in this video, we solve this particular problem. By simply putting integer here, we simply convert the value of the user input into this, and that will actually then will work. Okay? Then what's the problem with this? Is that the problem with this, now we have a problem that will come later. Now in video 5, in this particular video, basically I talk general about, how to work with Python and so on and so forth. But when we talk about video number six, which is right here, which is talking about, we're trying to recreate LabSheet 1, but in Python. And if you remember in LabSheet 1 in Python, we wanted to do validation. Remember that? And I think, if I remember correctly, in our Telegram group, I provided you with an F statement logic, or a tree of F statements that you want to check. Now, at the time when I made that F statement or nested F statements, I was thinking Python 3. Now, I'm opening the Telegram room in another video. Now, what I'm trying to say is that the fact that input now no longer have context and will always capture as a string, we're going to create a problem later on when you're trying to work with inputs. Because, first of all, what if the user could actually input the following values? Okay. The user could provide you, you want the user, okay, target. Okay, what is the target? I want the user to input integer. I want user to input integer and nothing else. Okay? Only integer. Okay? And reject everything else. Okay? And reject everything else. So the problem is that in my video, in my sixth video, or my following video, which is right here, video number six, I also created that video based on Python 2.7, unfortunately. So therefore, I used the concept of context, or using the input as context, to help me in my validation. In other words, when the user types 7, though, so input will help me to capture that as an integer, and when the user types text, input will capture that as a string. So that actually helps as well, and the same thing for a float. And I applied that logic when I was testing for validation. But of course, that all of that doesn't work anymore. So that's why if you're watching video 6 again, you have to put in mind that video 6 once again uses input in the old way. So input in video 6 also uses the context or the way Python 2 works. But then, of course, that doesn't work anymore for us today. Now, when you use input like this, this will always be a string. Okay, so, but then how then you achieve this? You want an integer, but then no matter what the user types, it will always be an input, a string. So how do you solve this? Well, I have the following, I applied this actually in my, this is another program that I created for my robotics course. It's a very long one, but I do have a validation section. Let me just jump through quickly. Actually, this is for the other course, which is Forward Robotics. And if you come to your my other video channel or my other course, you will see, you will actually have to work with this program at some point. So these are my validation functions. And you notice how I said functions, not function, because I have different types of validations. You can ignore all of the other stuff. You can actually ignore all of these things because they apply to my program, but then you only care, or let's focus only here. So what I did was, in my validation function, basically I wanted to check one thing. I didn't care about float or integer, but I wanted to check whether the user have inputted a value or a number or a variable, a number or a text. So where is it? Validation main. Oh, no, not this one. Sorry. Validation main is something else. So this is the one, okay. So what I did was use the input message, and yeah, right here. You know, okay. So maybe this is not a good idea because this code is scary. So I'm gonna do it here. So what's the logic behind it? So first of all, what do you want to? If the user inputs whatever the user inputs, right? You want to check the following. First of all, check if number or text. Okay, whether it was an integer or a float, they are both numbers. Is that right? So we want to, first of all, eliminate the fact that the user could have typed text. So we want to eliminate this possibility right here. So that's the first target. Okay, and then let's say if that was correct, if that was all right, check, let's say, if true, if this situation is true, then check if integer or integer or no, yeah, check if integer. That's it. Because if it's a number, right, let's say, let's just put that here. Check if number or text, okay? If it's true, that means it's a number. So if it's a number, you only have two possibilities, only a float or an integer. So then the next line will be check if integer or a float. This is not a code, and this is just a pseudocode or algorithm, right? Okay, so if that's also true, then value okay, then proceed, okay? Proceed. If it's not okay, then basically go back and re-enter. So go back here, and then also, oh wait, there's one more check actually. There's one more value, one more test. After integer, if the value is an integer, then check if within limits, okay? If it's less than 8, whatever, I don't remember the program. Okay, so if that's also true, then the value is okay, then proceed with the function. Otherwise, you'll have to provide, go back to user, re-enter, okay? And then this one will repeat twice, actually three times. Copy here, and copy here, and copy here. So this one will be right here. Oops. This is not a real code, this is just a pseudocode, okay? Or basically just an algorithm for us to think about. So this is how this a block of line works. So check, first of all, check if, let's not do that this way. Let's just say if number, yeah. Actually, it's right here, so it's just gonna, yeah. So check if number or text. And then if it's a real number, then check if the number is an integer or float, and then it's check within the limit, then it's easy. Let's just start with the easiest one right here. How do you know whether it's an if within if the limit? We just basically use an if. The this right here, the way to apply this one is will be with an if simple if x is less than or equal or greater than or equal, limit. Okay, so that's how you do it. Okay, how about this one? Now, for a minute, right? That at this point, we have guaranteed. Okay, once we reach this point, we have guaranteed that the value is an integer. Because if it's not an integer, we would not even get to this point. It will already exit. Okay, what does that mean? So let's just see it this way. So we start from this line. If it's a text, then none of this will execute. Okay, if it's a text, in other words, it has failed, it will come down here. So that will be essentially the else part. Else, go back here. So basically, if is number, yeah, I think that's how I wrote it in the Telegram group. If it's a number, then okay, proceed. If it's not a number, then this will be false, and therefore all of this code will be failed, and therefore we will be here. Okay, so this will actually execute. Okay, so by the time we reached here, so definitely it's a number. Let's just agree on that. So well, how this is going to look is going to be if is number. Okay, now what do you need to know? Now that it's a number, you want to check if it's an integer, right? Actually, we don't want to check if it's a number. We just want to check if it's an integer. Because you see, by the time we reached here, we know for sure it's a number because it's already passed this test. So if it's a number, then it's already an integer. Okay, so now you want to, if it's already a number. Now you want to check whether it's an integer or not. So if it was an integer, then it's already here. So by the time we reach this line, we already know for sure that x is an integer. So now we can compare it with the limit. You know, the limit was 5 just now in the earlier program. So now we can now compare it with this 5, and this will work, and then the testing will work. If it's valid, it will proceed, and we can work with the value, like print out or whatever. Print a value or something like that, and so on and so forth. Or calculate, sum, something like that. You know what I mean? So this is basically the problem. Now, if it wasn't within the limit, it's going to exit from here. So this is going to be here, else here. And if it wasn't an integer, let's say if it was a float, then it would also exit here. So let's say if it was an integer, it will come inside. If it wasn't an integer, if it was a float, then none of this will run. It will all fail and it will come down here, and then this will also exit, go back to the user. But then if it's an integer, then we are here. Then if it's within the limits, then we're good to go. We can proceed. If it's not within the limit, then it will go back to the user. Okay? Now, your question in your mind right now is that, okay, that one we know how to do, but then how do we do this one? Okay, so first things first. You have to agree that by the time we reached here, the value is definitely a number. Okay? Which means that x at this point, right? We have to put it right here. So I'm going to put it in a comment. I'm trying to explain the code you're going to achieve to do your validation. Okay? So at this point, the value, or let's call it x, x is a number. Okay? Integer or float. Well, we're not sure which one, but it's definitely one of these two. Okay? And at this stage, we don't know yet what is the input is. Okay? So at this point, right here, So I was just saying, at this point, x is an integer. X is an integer. But we still could be outside of the limit. Is that right? So the last point, which is right here, here actually. So right here, at this point, x is an integer, and also and within limits, okay? So what happens here? Well, if it comes here, that means basically it's an integer, but outside the limit, okay? If it comes at this point. Integer, okay, it's an integer, all right, but outside limits, okay? And what about here? If it arrives at this point, that means at this point, x is a float. And obviously fails the test. And finally, this one right here, basically x is a string. Okay, so hopefully now you can see the whole picture of what's going on in this nested if statement. You know what I mean? Once we reach this point, basically, at this point, what about here? So this one right here, at this point, x could be anything, okay? Could be str, could be integer, could be float. We don't know yet for sure, okay? Actually, that is here. This could be here. And if you were thinking about it, then you're right. And this should be before the if statement and not after it. And then that means this guy is already also above. And then we're good to go. So let's see now. So at the beginning, right, we don't know what the value could be anything, right? Could be a string, could be a float, could be an integer, right? Now we tested it here. So if it's a text, it's going to come out here. It's going to come out at this if, at this else statement right here. So if it's not a string, so at this point, x is a number. We know that for sure, okay? So now when it comes to here, so but that number could be an integer or a float. After we do this test, then definitely at this point, x is an integer. Otherwise, it's going to be a float, which is right here. And again, it's going to exit. Now, okay, one final test, which is check with the value within the limit. If it's within the limit, then right here, then at this point, x is an integer and within the limit. Then we are good to go. Otherwise, if it's not, if it fails this test right here, then we are here, which means it's an integer, but outside the limits. Okay? So the next question is, I know how to do this one, sir. It's very easy. We just have to check the value if it's less than or equal using the regular if statement and the regular, operators, then we'll be good to go. But then what about here? Okay, once again, remember that at this point, when we reach this if statement, we already have, the user input is a number. However, it is still a string. If you are shocked right now, like, what? What I mean is that it's a number, but it's still in a string format. What does that mean? It could be this. Okay, you know what? I think examples would have been perfect. So what does that mean? Basically, the user could have inputted, So let's just put it here. So actually, let's do it right here. So this is what the possibilities what the user could have inputted, right? So it could be SDAFS. That's a string. Is that right? An integer could be 7. And a float, this could be 7.3 or 7.4. If you look at them, they're all strings, is that right? But then what the user typed could be what we meant here. So at this stage, this could be any of these three values, is that right? But then now, at this point, after we do this test, which I will show you in a minute, we are now limited to these two options, which means we are limited now to these two options. So although technically speaking, these two options are strings, but they are actually written in numbers. That's what I meant by it's a number, okay? So now that you know for sure that the value could be a 7 or a 7.4 or an integer or a float, but in package as a string, then now we can simply come and do this. We can simply do this function, float, or we can simply cast x. So float x. So whether it was a 7 or 7.4, we simply cast it as a float. What is the result of this? We're basically going to end up with this situation. We can end up with either 7.0, which is what happens when you cast this guy, or we could end up with 7.4, which the value you see right here. Okay? So after you take this value, whether it's here or here, and you cast it into a float, you can end up with a situation like this. It's definitely a float. There's no guarantee, but the float could have a value after the decimal or could have a zero after the decimal. Okay? Well, that thing after the decimal has a name in mathematics. It's called the modulus. Modulus. Okay? So all you really have to do at this point, just check the modulus value. If the modulus value is essentially is greater than zero, then it's obviously a float. Otherwise, it will be an integer. What does that mean? Well, basically, we come here. Actually, we do this line up before the if statement. So basically, come and do it here. Okay, so after you float the value, okay, at this point, we know for sure that it's a number. How did you know that? I'll show you the test here later. But for now, we know for sure there is only one of these two possibilities. So what do? You do this code. You float x, and the end result of this will be either 7 or 7.0 or 7.4, okay? And then after that, what you're going to do, you're going to basically check for modulus, or check for modulus. Okay, and then apply the simple statement. If modulus, let's just call it m, right, is basically greater than zero, right? If it's greater than zero, what do you think? If it's greater than zero, then we are here, right? And therefore, it's essentially a float. So x is a float. Else, if it's not, then obviously x, if let's say if the modulus is actually equal to zero, then obviously x is an integer. Is an integer. And what do you do in this case? We simply now cast it as integer and we don't have to worry about it. So this will become x and that will be an integer and then we'll be good to go. And then definitely the value is an integer and then we can use it here. So that's how this works. So basically the if statement or the logic that you do is actually, this is the one where you do here. You get what I mean? That you check for the modulus. Then let's say if that was true, if let's say if the value of the modulus was greater than zero, then you go out. Basically, it's the value has failed. Or if it's not equal to, basically it's equal to zero, therefore we are here. So then you can then cast the value as integer, and then you can then proceed. From then on in, we know for sure that it's an integer. Now, if you don't like the modulus, there is another way. Okay. There is a function called round. You might be familiar with it from Excel. Okay. So here's a very quick and very nice and neat trick. So we can, let's just create a temporary variable. Let's just call it b. And b will simply equal to x minus round x. That's it. Zero here, just to remove the decimals. So let's think about it for a minute. If this was the value 7, right? So what would be the value here? That would be 7 here. Is that right? What would be the round of 7? If I want to take or round down, if you wish, actually not option. This really you have to use round down, yeah. Round, I think it's in floor, yeah. In Python, it's called floor. It's in round down. Let me try and Google it. Round, I'm trying to find the round down. Python, yeah. So round down, oh, there is a, the for you have to use the math library to do round. Actually, there is a round by itself, but if you want to round, you have to use floor, and floor requires the math library. So I have to install the math library. So go up here and simply forgot how to include the library in Python. Go up. Import, sorry, not include. Include is C++, I think. So import math, or actually math, or no, from math import floor. Okay, so now I can come down here now and write floor. Floor is exactly round down. Okay, so floor, yeah, x.0. So since, you know what, let's just start with this guy right here, okay? So if I put x, which is going to be 7.4, and I floor it down, what will be the value? Obviously, this will be equal to 7, right? Because when you floor it, it's like rounding down. That will equal to this value. And even if it was 7.9, example, right, or 7.8, it will also be, even if this number was 7.8, floor or round down will also equal to 0. Okay, so you will always ignore whatever decimals are going to give you 0 at the end. So the original value was 7.8 or 7.4, whatever value other than 0, right? You will always end up with this. So the end result, what will be this value? Will obviously equal to 0.8, or maybe in our original number was 7.4, right? So this will be 7.4. In other words, that this small trick right here, this small code right here, will give you the value of the decimals that you have right here with the number, okay? Now, if this value, if the value, of, then you can simply check the value for B, right? If B is greater than zero, right? Is greater than zero, then obviously, what does that mean? This is not code, this is pseudocode, yeah? So obviously, this means, what is my equal sign? Yeah. So obviously, X is a float. Is that right? If B is greater than zero, right? Then obviously X is a float. Is that right? Then obviously else will, it means what basically? Else essentially X is an integer. Or if you want to be specific, let's just write it down again. So copy and So if B is equal to zero or is equal to zero, yeah, equal to zero, right? Then obviously x is an integer. So what about negative numbers? There's a very easy solution for that. We just simply have to put absolute. So basically we can just put abs here. Absolute basically means that if the value was negative or the values were negative, you will end up with a negative value. So you just ignore the negative sign. So if let's say the number was negative 7.4, so you're going to get negative 7.4 here, and this will be 7 or maybe negative 8. You will end up with simply negative 4. That actually is going to fail here. So in order to avoid this failure, we just use absolute on the outside. So this negative is going to go away. You'll end up with just the 0.4. So if there's a decimal value, then obviously it's a float. Otherwise, if it's a 0, if it's like this, so obviously, therefore, X is a float, okay? So in the second example, or in the second number, when X was, okay, let me just put it here. So let's put FX equal to 7.4, okay? So in this particular example, here's the situation. So obviously, we verify that it's actually a float. But then what if it was 7.0? So obviously, it's right here. So this will be 7.0. So this will be, let me just adjust this a little bit. So this will be here, and also let's just adjust this a little bit. Yeah, so this will obviously be 7. Let me drop the zeros or the negatives for now. So this is obviously going to be 7, right? And the floor of 7.0 is also 7.0. So therefore, the difference between them will be 0 or 0.0, okay? It doesn't matter whether it's 0 or 0.0, it's the same answer. So obviously, in this case, if B is equal to 0, which is this line right here, so obviously 7, is the number that you entered is actually an integer. You get what I mean? So if that's the case, we can just simply recast X. X is equal to integer x, which is the line that I put here. Okay, so this is how you check whether the value was a float or an integer. So you you have to remember that this technique that you use here hinges on one fact, that at this point we are guaranteed 100% that the user input is either this or looks like this or looks like that. Basically, it's either an integer or a float, but obviously as a string. Okay. All right. So how about earlier? How about here? See, at this point, the input could be one of these three items. So how do we actually solve this particular problem? So how do we do that? Essentially, we cannot use an if statement anymore here. We will have to use try and check. And I'm going to borrow it from here. So go down here. Where's my validate? The validate function. Oh, yeah, right here. So I'm going to actually basically come and take this whole thing. Yeah, I think that's it. Actually, only these two lines. Yeah, copy. And then come here. So basically, what I'm going to do right now, at this point, we have that. Basically, what we're going to do, we're going to have to use what is called a try and exception. So except the try exception, not except. It is except, but without the capital letter. Okay, so except. Okay, so what is try and except? A try and except essentially is, you can call it an if statement, but a much more powerful if statement. What's going on here? We're not going to do an if statement. We're going to try something. And the reason why we put it in a try box here is that because we were worried that this line of code might cause an error. And if it caused an error, we don't want the program to crash. Well, we want something to happen. We can print a message like, error, you have typed something, or invalid result, or something like that. And that's exactly what we do in the validation function. In the validation function, we are checking the value. And then if the value is okay, then we accept it. Otherwise, we simply return to the user. So in an earlier structure, when we did it here, we use an if statement. Is that right? Well, over here, we're not going to use an if statement. What is that other if statement? Yeah, here, right here. Copy right here. Unfortunately, we can use an if statement, but we have to, inside here, we have to put a try block. Okay? What is a try block is right here. Try and except. So what we're going to do, we're going to do this simple test right here. This right here is now x. Okay? Yeah, right. So now we know for sure that basically the user could have inputted one of these values, as you can see right here. Okay? It's either a string, as you can see right here, or it could be 7 or 7.4, but written as a string. Is that right? What do we want right now? We want to eliminate this guy. We don't want to, these two we'll worry about them later, but for now we want to eliminate this guy right here. So how do we do that? Simply with this line of code right here. We are simply going to cast whatever the user inputted as float x and then try to add to 1. Simple as that. I know this sounds weird, but hear me out. So if the user inputted a 7, obviously this will become 7.0, and 7.0 plus 1 is going to work, and the result will become 8.0. Is that right? So this will work. Is that right? Now, what about 7.4? 7.4 will come here, obviously will turn into a number. 7.4 plus 1 will become 8.4. So these two will work when we try to attempt this code, this simple line here. But this line will not work. This type of input, if I put it here, it will not work. First of all, this line alone, float x, will not work, because float will try it or will attempt to turn SDAFS into a number or into a float, but it won't work because it's not a number, it's a string. And then when you try to add it to a 1, it will also not work. So this will fail only if x is equal to this SDAFS. You know what I mean? So this will fail. What do you mean by fail? It means it's going to cause an error. Okay, so obviously, can we just use an if statement? No, because even if you put an if statement, this will cause an error. right? You remember what happened earlier in the program when we were trying to do, what is it? This one right here, right? Remember this error? This is an if statement right there. And then even though it wasn't an if statement, but it still caused an error, right? When it was like this, you know what I mean? So an if statement will only work to check for a condition. So let's see now the difference between if statement and a try block. An if statement is going to check for a certain condition, but the try block is going to check for an error. That's what it's going to do. It's going to try and check for an error. So if what's going on here is that we're going to try this block because we're not sure. So when do you use a try block? Is that when you are not sure how or whether your code is going to cause an error or not. And most of the time, it is associated with user input. So basically, you take this user input and you basically put it here. So if you take this user input value, and if the user inputted this line was going to cause an error. But the program will not going to crash because we already put it inside a try block. Okay? So if it fails, what's going to happen then? If this fails, this is going to execute. So right here, if it fails, then you can put your print statement, which is the thing that you put here. Okay, we can simply take this print statement, right? And simply say print value is, or entered value, or entered input, or just say input, yeah? Or invalid input. Invalid input. Please enter an integer. Okay, and then of course you need to ask the user to re-input again. So again, I'm going to leave this part for you here, and then ask user to input. Basically, go back in the loop and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Okay, so how does this work now? How does this block of code work? If you're not familiar with try and accept. So if let's say if this worked, let's say if the user really did input 7, what's going to happen? Well, this is going to work. And if this is going to work, then this is not going to work. So if this is going to work, then what? Then we are good to go. Then all of this is fine. And then we come here now. And then basically, so obviously if the value is good, then we are here now. We can simply say value is either this or that. Value is a number, yes, sorry. Value is a number. But it could still be one of these two. You know what I mean? So at this stage, we have verified that the user has inputted a value, which is essentially then can be verified. So at this point, X, we know for sure that X is a number. And there's already a float. So, I mean, you don't really have to do it again here, right? Because it's already have been done here inside the try block. So if this has happened already, so at this point, X has already been floated. You know what I mean? So this is how you basically check whether the value was input or not. Let me show you the real function in my other program. So basically what I did was essentially I put the whole block inside a while true. Okay. And this is my function, which is the validation function. Okay. So the validation function requires the value itself and some text and some limit, low limit and upper limit. And then ignore this line for a second. So basically a while true, which is the loop that checks with the user value. So then try, and then we do this right here, just to check if this fails, the user did not input. I wrote it down, but user did not input a number, okay? So if this passes, then now I'm updating the value. Now I'm making the casting permanent. If this fails, the line will stop here, and we're gonna jump. If this really fails, none of this code is going to run, and then we're gonna jump straight away to the accept, and it's gonna say input value, the value must be a number. But if this was all right and the user did input a number, then I'm going to make the change permanent. So that I'm going to now cast it permanently into a number, into a float, and then I'm going to check whether it's within the limits. Okay? If the value is all right, I'm going to break the loop, which is this is the purpose of the break right here. So break means this has been done. Thank you very much. And then return. So the loop has now been completed. If the value is all right, then break. At this point, that means the value at this point has now been validated. So you return the value. So that's how this works. So once again, what happens was this is the validation function. It takes the value that you want to validate, some messaging, some text messages, some, you know, notification messages, and then lower input and lower limit and upper limit. And then you can ignore this because it's about the messages and all the stuff. By the way, this is the Unicode for theta. And then basically this is my while loop. Once again, I'm going to go through this code. Basically, we ask the user to input the value. Value is equal to input. The text here is please input the value, blah, 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 right? And this is basically the value of the message. And then now what we're going to do, we try and check the value. If this is true, if this works, then okay, thank you. Now we make it permanent into a float. And now then we can apply the if statement. And if it's all good, if this is also true, then break. Break means get out of the loop. We have found the value that we're looking for and then return the value. Now, if this is not true, if this is failed, then we are here. Value must be within limits. Okay, and if this is also failed, this is going to come out of the try block altogether. It's going to come here. It's going to say invalid, try again, and then it's going to try again. It's going to loop again in a while true loop. So this is going to keep on happening until we get to this point. So that's how I do validation, which is validate. But this in this particular example, I did not check for integer. I only check for float. If you want to check for integer, then you need to come here now and apply the code that I showed you earlier here, which is about this particular trick right here. You could simply come and do this. You can simply say, you can just come and do this. Actually, I can do that right now. So just say, copy this code. I can put it here. So we can say b is equal to absolute value plus, I think I already have math in this program. I have math, but I did not import a floor, so I'm going to import it here. So floor, okay. So basically, absolute value, floor, and then value. Okay, so the end result of this will be whatever decimal value of this, right? So after that, I can put an if statement. If b is greater than zero, not greater than or equal, just greater than zero, or dot zero right here, then in this case, we are now can take this other if statement. Oh, no, wait. This is now at this point, if this is true, then in this case, integer. Value is integer. Okay? Otherwise, we just put a say here else, then in this case, value is float. Again, I mean, and that's it. That's basically all. Basically, by putting this code right here and then putting a simple if statement, and now we have the integer. Now that you are here, then you can come down here and you can put your checking the limits kind of break, and also under break as well. Basically, you can take this whole block now, right? Which when we check the limits, copy, and we can put it here. Okay, and just comment out this part. You know what? I'll just delete it. It's okay, I'll undo all of this later. Okay, so now we have this. Oops, what happened? So now this is my three levels of validation. So first, number one, we check whether the user has inputted a text. How do you do that? By simply doing float. Okay, so if the float is fine, if this works, so now we can proceed for the rest of the block. If not, and this will exit right here, and then we can simply say this is not a number, and then the while loop is going to start all over again. Basically, once we're done with this code, we're going to go back up to the while true loop and start all over again. Also, if the user once again types a random text, so this whole block is not going to work, and then this is going to do it run again, and then we're going to start all over again. So now let's say the user now inputted, for example, a 7.5. Okay, for example, yeah. Just say the user typed, 7.5. Okay. So if that was to happen the case, so this will work. Okay, this function is going to work. So what are we going to do now? We're going to now cast the value permanently by putting the equal sign. So now the value is not this, actually, it's going to equal to exactly 7.5, really the float value right here. Then what do we do now? We take this value and we put it here. So now we'll have 7.5 here, right? And that will be 7.0, is that right? Because the floor of 7.5 will be 0. So when you minus these two right here and you get the absolute value, so the end result of this will become 0.5. Okay? So now we come and test here. So if the value of this was greater than zero, which means, oh, sorry, it's the wrong test. This has to be equal to zero. Sorry. If it's equal to zero, then integer. Otherwise, it's a float. Okay? So if obviously, if the value is equal to zero, right? So right now, the value for b is equal to 0.5. So if the fb is equal to zero, obviously, it's not. So this whole thing is not going to run. We're going to end up with here. So then we can then... I can come here and say another print statement and say print invalid input value must be an integer. Okay? So what about this thing over here? Ignore it. This is just for my own messages. Okay? Or if you want, you can then screenshot this code right now and read it yourself, and hopefully you'll get the idea what's going on here. Yeah, but otherwise you can ignore this and just you can say here value must be within limits. I think that should be fine. And you can ignore this code right here. And you can also ignore this whole code right here. So you're damaging your program. Don't worry about it. Okay, so basically now this could be your validation function. So basically the step number one, which is validate if it's text or... to validate if it's text, basically all you have to do is just do this, put it in a try box, all of this, and then do the float line. If this works, that means obviously it's a string or an integer. Then the next step will be right here to do this value minus the float value. If this is the value right here, and if it's zero, then obviously it's an integer. If it's an integer, then we are here. If it's an integer, yeah, if the value is an integer, then we need to do one more casting step, yeah, right here. So once we are here, we basically come and take value and we simply put it here. And this time we will simply recast it as integer to force it. Now we know for sure it's an integer, so we just cast it as an integer. And then now we check with the limit. In my particular program, I have upper and lower limits. In your case, you only have an upper or lower, so only one of these two. So you can ignore the other one. And then check. So basically, that's how your while program works. So you have while true running through the whole thing. So if this works, fantastic. We can proceed with the rest of the code. If it doesn't work, then we're just going to jump here. Give a feedback message and start all over again. Now, if the user typed indeed 7.5 or 7, so this is going to work. So if it's a 7.5, this will be the case. Then it's going to come down here, and then B is going to have a value. If D is going to have a value, then we are basically going to end up here, because definitely if the value is greater than 0, then it's going to be a float. We don't need it. But if the value essentially is 0, and when will that happen if the user typed a 7? If the user typed a 7, this will work. This will work. And then the value here will be 7.0 because we are telling the program to cast it into a 7. So then 7.0 minus 7.0, which is the floor of 7.0, then this will become 0 again. So therefore, this will work. And if this will work, the value is definitely 7. So now the value can be turned into finally 7, which is exactly what the user intended. So then we take the value, and then now we can test within the limits. If it's within the limit, then break the loop and get out of the loop. We're good to go. We have the value at hand. And then return the value to the user. Return the value is return it to the function. Essentially, this is basically a function validate. You provide it with the input, and then it's going to give you return the number that it has been validated. Okay? If it wasn't within the limit, then this message is going to come out, and then the loop is going to play one more time. Just one final thing is that, just to clean it up a little bit, these are just examples, the numbers I throw all over the program, but the actual code actually is this. So hopefully now, with this, so the point of this video that I right now is to give you an idea on, I think this is it. So the point of the video today was essentially to account for this problem that was shown in this particular example. Hopefully you understand what happened. Number one. Number two, the bigger picture is that you need to understand the difference between Python 2 and Python 3. So make sure you study these two links, which I'm going to share in the description of this video. This is a general idea. It explains to you what was the reason for the change and what's the motivation and how you should and why you should learn both of them, basically. I don't mean learn both languages. I mean learn the differences, at least. And this second link right here, this should be your reference, really, because it walks you through every difference between Python 2 and Python 3. and also compares the code side by side between them. And finally, in the rest of the video, I simply walk you through the code of doing validation for string and for float, as well as for integer. So I hope this helps you out in both, I hope it helps you out in your Python learning journey, as well as in LabSheet 2. Okay, so I think with this, we are done with this video. Thank you very much, guys, for your time. It's about 1 hour plus. Relatively a short video. So once again, thank you guys, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.